Daniel chapter number 3, verse number 12. Something's spilling. I don't know what it is. Sound systems are of the devil, there's no doubt. They'll come in here temperamental, be good one week, and the next week, it's got 35 demons in it. Amen. Daniel chapter 3, verse number 12, says, there are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Again, Daniel chapter 3 and verse 12 says, there are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. And if you'll turn with me to Luke chapter number 21, we'll begin in verse 23. Luke chapter 21, verse 23 says, but woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. For there shall be great distresses in the land and wrath upon this people, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's heart failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Before I read my last verse, as I was reading this morning the scripture that said men's hearts failing them for fear, I have to tell you something that happened to us Friday night. We were laying in the bed there. I had just fallen asleep not too long. And all of a sudden, something came into our room and began to tear it apart. Things were falling off the wall. I heard glass breaking. I heard a wild banshee sleeping next to me come up and begin to scream at the top of her lungs. And you talk about somebody's heart failing them for fear. I got up and couldn't figure out what was going on. There was stuff all over the floor. There was glass in the floor. I ran, got cows, told him, I said, boy, get out of that bed right now. Somebody's knocked our window out. They're trying to get in. I said, let's go. I don't even think I had my glasses. We grabbed a shotgun and a flashlight, and around that house we went. We were shining. We were looking. Couldn't find any of those clowns that had been all over the news. I thought for sure there'd be four of them outside having a party. All it was one of them old widowmaker limbs about 30 foot up in that tree decided to finally let go, and as it come down, it slapped the power lines, and it done a 360 spin, and it come through the glass window of our bedroom. But I want to tell you something, Brother Stephen, it shook this old boy that I wasn't able to go back to sleep till about 5 o'clock, because every time my eyes would just close just a little bit, I could hear that wild banshee. My old heart was a-beating. My old heart was men's heart failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with the power of great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Somebody lift your hands right now and say, my redemption is drawing nigh. Hallelujah. My redemption is drawing nigh. Amen. I want to preach to you from this subject topic this morning. Standing out in Babylon. standing out in Babylon. Would you lift your voices with me right now and begin to pray all over this house? Father, I pray right now, God, that you would reach down to our midst. Father, that you would begin to minister to us today, O Lord. God, I pray right now that you would drench us with your Spirit. God, I pray that you would drench us with your Holy Ghost. Lord, I pray that you would reach down right now, that you would let the anointing of the Holy Ghost begin to minister in this place. God, that you would speak to us today as we worship you in spirit and in truth. God, that you would begin to work out problems and situations that are in this house. God, I know that all the world knows that your power is greater than anything. God, all power is given unto you in heaven and in earth. And Lord, today I pray for that power to fall in this sanctuary. Let the supernatural unfold. Let miracles, signs, and wonders prevail in this house today. We'll love you and give you praise. If you love God, would you clap your hand up to the Lord right now, for he is great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated if you would like. Amen. I'm going to turn your attention back to the book of Daniel, chapter number 3, and I'm going to read a few verses of scripture there and set a foundation for my message today. Amen. Standing out in Babylon. Daniel chapter number 3 and verse number 1 is where the story begins to unfold. And it says, Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 80 cubits, and the breadth thereof 6 cubits, and he set it up in the plain of Dura, in the province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king that sent together the princes and the governors and the captains and the judges and the treasurers and the counselors and the sheriffs and all the rulers or the elite of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And then the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces were gathered together unto the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had stood up. And then a herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at the time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, that you fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." Therefore, at the time when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and all kinds of music, that the people, the nations, and the languages fell down and worshiped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Wherefore, at that time, Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews, and they spake and said unto the king, "Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and the dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoso falleth not down, worship that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." And then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if you be ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if you worship not, you shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands?" And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said unto the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known that unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the gods golden image which thou hast set up. And then Nebuchadnezzar, full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 7 times more than it was to be heated. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to cast them into a burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their hose, and their hats, and other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent, and the furnace was exceeding hot, the flame of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these 3 men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished, and rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did we not cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire? And they said unto him, true, O king. And he answered and said, lo, I see 4 men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the 4th is like the Son of God. It's a lot of scripture. A lot of words. But throughout this chapter we find that there were thousands of people that had been gathered together. All of the class, all of the elite, all of the dignitaries, so to speak, were in attendance. All of those who had political clout were in attendance. Everybody who was somebody was in attendance. Everybody who claimed to be a leader was in attendance. But there was only 3 men that decided, I will stand out in Babylon. Out of all the people in attendance, there were 3 Hebrew boys that decided that I will be the one to stand out. You know what? Seeing these 3 men gathered together reminds me of a scripture. And it goes something like this, where 2 or 3 are gathered together in my name, there will I be in the midst. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you this morning that it did not matter the circumstances. It did not matter where they were headed. They said, I'm going to stand up in the face of Babylon. I'm going to stand up in the face of this image. I will not worship. I'm going to stand out. And when they said that, there was 3 of them. And even though their destination was in the midst of a fiery furnace, God said, hey, if you just go there in my name, I will show up. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to present to you that on this Sunday morning, because somebody decided to stand out and be separate, because somebody decided to be different, God showed up on the scene. And when that king began to look into the fiery furnace, they weren't burnt, they weren't smelling like smoke, even their clothes weren't stenched. But the most important thing was that there was somebody that was more powerful than that fire that had taken the lives of those that had put them in. Can I tell you that sometimes God will use a fire to take care of those things that are holding you captive, and it'll quench and burn it off, and God will show up in the middle of your dilemma. I preach to you on this Sunday morning. You don't have to fear where you're headed. You don't have to fear where the devil is trying to take you. Know that God will be in your midst, and he is able, the Bible says, to deliver. Of a fiery furnace. Guess who decided to show up? Ladies and gentlemen, can I tell you that if you'll keep the main thing, that God will always show up on your behalf, that God will always show up in your dilemma. I preach to you that on this Sunday morning, every time that you'll stand up for Jesus, that Jesus will show up for you. Every time you stand up for the Word of God, the Word of God will stand up for you. Every time that you stand out and be counted, ye separate, saith the Lord, you will find out that God will always come on the scene and make a way of escape. I'm preaching to you on this Sunday morning not to get you hyped up, riled up, or excited, that I'm here to preach to you that the name of Jesus is greater than any form of captivity. It's far greater than any form of punishment. It's greater than any kind of bindings that the devil today. And it's trying to take our eyes off of the church. It's trying to hinder our vision with images. But God is looking for His chosen few to stand out. And I say, regardless of what everyone else is doing, regardless of how everyone else is acting, that I refuse to bow down to the music of the Pied Piper. The world's music will not have an effect on me, and that it's having on everybody else. I refuse to dance to the tune of the music. I refuse to bow to the tune of the music. I refuse to live to the tune of the music. I refuse to let those images cause me to bow down like everybody else. But I've got a Hebrew boy atmosphere in my life, and a spirit about me that said, I'm going to stand up and be counted. I don't care if it hurts the Pope and causes to break all the time to fall. I'm going to live for God in the face of adversity. I'm going to live for God every day, not just on Sunday. But I'm going to stand up and be part of the chosen few. I'm going to stand up and be counted. I'm going to count all things as lost and everything for gain, because I'm going to stand out in a spirit of battle. Sure, everyone else is doing it. Everyone else is committing sins. Everyone else is bowing to those images. But you were not designed like everyone else. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but ye are a chosen generation, a peculiar people, a holy nation. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell us that God chose us, that God called us, and God separated us, and we're not supposed to be like everybody else. And when the Pied Piper begins to play all kinds of music, the children of God are not supposed to bow down to it. We're supposed to stand straight and tall and wave our hand and say, my God, I don't care if this world wants to go to hell. I'm designed to go to heaven. I'm designed to stand tall. I'm designed to be real. I'm designed to be greater. I got it for God if nobody else does it. I got to go to heaven if nobody else does. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My mama used to say it like this. I tell her, Mama, all the kids are doing it. All the kids are going down to the local bar. All the kids are going down to the local clubs. All the kids, it's the cool thing to do. And she looked at me one day and she said, son, if all the kids were jumping off of bridges, would you do that? And I looked at her and I said, Mama, I probably would, just so I could be part of the crowd. And she said, that's the problem. You're more worried about being part of the crowd than you are about following the righteousness of God. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you something. I was a little boy, but that had such an effect on me. I don't want to look like the world. I don't want to act like the world. I don't want to be part of it. I want to do what the scripture said, come ye out and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. My God, all we need is 2 or 3 in this world of Babylon that's willing to stand up and be counted and say, I'll stand strong. I'll stand tall. I refuse to be counted. Hallelujah. Everybody else, the music would start playing. And I'm going to tell you, that's probably where they got the story of the Pied Piper. They begin to play those flutes. Begin to play those psalteries and the harps. Begin to play all the music, the dulcimers. All of those things, and when they hit, everybody would fall flat on their face. You see, isn't it just like the devil to take the thing that God gave the church to create an atmosphere of praise and worship? That's why music was created. That's why music was created, to set an atmosphere. Isn't it just like that, that the devil would take what God used to create an atmosphere, and he would take and use it against the church, and when they would set up an image, that everybody would begin to worship that image and to listen to that music. That's why it's important, ladies and gentlemen, what comes across your radio. That's why it's important what's in your CD player. That's why it's important what you know's in your ears. Because the devil will always try to take that that God has given to the church and use it against the church. It is important, ladies and gentlemen. And when all the rest of the world is doing it, that's no excuse. They were young men. History tells us that these men had not even left their teens. Well, that blows your mind, doesn't it? These were still young men. You see, today's teenagers are not like those teenagers were. There were kings that ruled at 12 and 13 years of age. There were kings that ruled. You didn't even know when you went out to war who was going to come back, so they had to teach their teenagers at a very young age. These men were set up governing. They were young men, possibly teenagers, but still they had enough training and enough of God that they made up their minds. Brother Blake, I don't care what the rest of the world's doing today. The Bible said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love him." And we know that the first commandment is don't have any other gods before me. So if somebody sets up an image and tells me that I got to bow down to it, I don't care what they say. I don't care what the consequences are. I know, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you what is wrong with our society today. It's not men and women like Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. What's wrong is the church's lack of trinity, of training our young people and raising them up to know what's right and what's wrong. I don't care what Washington does, but my God, this church is not the apostolic. This church is not the real. This church is not the clear. And I'm going to stand up. And I'm going to stand up. And I'm going to be captain of the chosen.
Amen.
Come on. Amen. Washington hasn't failed us. We failed Washington. Glory, I know that won't be real popular, but I'm going to tell you something. If we spend half as much time praying for them as we do talking about them, we'd see a difference.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to say that again. If we spend half of the time praying for them as we did, talking about them, we'd see a difference. I want to tell us, Brother Blake, that we better get back to the fundamentals that this apostolic church was founded upon. It wasn't built out of a program. It was built out of a prayer room. And we better get back to the basics. Babylon was a type of sin. Babylon was a place of debauchery. Babylon, the power, was a place where anything went. It was almost like Las Vegas. Hello?
Come on.
Man, I'm going to tell you something. I've been to Las Vegas 3 times. My first time, I went right through the middle of it. And my Jesus, have mercy. If you don't have to go right through the middle of Las Vegas, don't go right through the middle of Las Vegas. There was people beating on the side of my truck. There was folks that was shaking my truck. I went the wrong time. There were people doing all crazy stuff. They were out on the streets. And you think jokers and corners walk around naked. You go to Las Vegas. Woo, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, I almost got carnal just for a second. I get this little carnal. I won't talk about all of it. But there was more legs and thighs than you ever seen at KFC. And a few other chicken parts too. I ain't never in my life said that. My dad said, "My God, would you look at that?" I said, "I am." I don't think that's what he meant. That's what Babylon was like. Babylon was a place that it didn't matter. You just done your own thing. You just do whatever makes you feel good. It's kind of like a lot of preachers that are preached today. Hello, I'm not trying to toot my own horn, but I'm going to preach just for a second about the difference between a pastor and a preacher. You see, a preacher is somebody that will stand behind the pulpit and scratch your back and tell you what you want to hear for a good offering. But a pastor will stand behind the pulpit and he'll tell you what the Word of God said, and he don't care if you got to pay all the bills. Hello.
Come on.
Amen. That's 5 weeks. I'm going to preach on that for about 30 seconds. We need men of God that are willing to stand behind that pulpit and say, "Hey, Babylon is still a type of sin, and we got to come out from among it and be separate, saith the Lord." There wasn't but 3 people, but let me tell you what kind of revival that 3 people brought when they went through the fire. You see, we're tried by fire. We are tested by fire. When they went through the fire, amen, there was a revival on the other side of it. That king began to see the power of God in the fire. He looked around at men that were faithful in the fire. He looked at men that were faithful through circumstances, and he seen that orb. He said, "Oh, I see more." And that orb looks like the Son of God. Can I tell you? It's because he was the Son of God. If 2 or 3 people which are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, God will heal the land. You look at the revival that 3 men caused because they refused to bow the knee, because they refused to bow their backs. It was the greatest revival.
All it takes is somebody to look at somebody else and say, my mind's made up. I'm not going to be affected. I'm not going to let my vision be hindered. I'm not going to bow even a little bit. I'm going to stand tall. We know that perilous times shall come. We know that men shall be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. We know that we've got to be faithful. We know that men are going to become boastful, proud, fame seekers. But we also know that the chosen of God will be standing out and declaring that I'm not going to go with this flow. The Bible tells us that the pleasures of this world are just for a season. They're just for a season. I've heard men that stood in the pulpit and tell you, oh, there's no pleasures in the world. You don't need to go to the world because there's no pleasures. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll never hear me preach that. You know I was preaching a lie. There are pleasures in this world. And not all the pleasures in this world are sin. That went over like Long John's and Nudist Colony.
Come on.
Not all pleasures are sin. I like to hunt. I like to fish. Those are pleasures. They ain't sin.
Sure.
Unless I miss church to do it.
Come on.
Let me see you off into that just for real. I like to play a good round of golf. But you know what? I'm not late on Sunday morning to play golf.
Come on.
There's some other pleasures that I can go into and time all about, Brother Blake, but I'm going to tell you something. When you listen to this old pastor, because when you go back to tuning, when you go into the middle of that line, there's got to be somebody that's willing to stand.
Come on.
There's got to be somebody that's willing to be a light. Right in the middle of Tunica, I got a family over there. Come here, stand on this phone. His daddy pastors a home mission church in Tunica, Mississippi. And it's little Las Vegas. It's little Babylon. There's a whole lot of things that happen in Tunica. There's a sign right outside the city that says, what happens in Tunica stays in Tunica. Reminds you of anything else? Vegas. Little Vegas. Whole lot of sin going on. And you know what? There's going to be pressures. Let me preach to you just for a moment. Y'all hang out just for a second. I'm going to preach to you. There's going to be pressures in your life. And there's going to be people that say, hey, you know what? When you hear the music, you just need to bow just a little bit. Come on, you can bow one way or the other. I'm bigger than you. You can bow. He's driving. He's going to bow. I'm telling him the third time. You better bow. You know that it don't take everything that you do to live for God. You know that it don't take that separated lifestyle. You can listen. You hear the music, we gotta bow. We gotta bow. Oh, come on. There's some images. There's some images that's been built. Come on, you think I'm preaching about the three Hebrew boys this morning? I'm not. I'm preaching about Carr, Mississippi.
Come on. Amen.
There's some things. There's some images. Look how beautiful it is. They built it for us. They built it so that we would have something tangible. They built it that we would have something that we can see. We don't need a God that we can't see. We need something that we can worship, something we can put our hands on. So let's just bow to it just a little bit. Let's just bow. Listen, the music is playing. Oh, let's just worship this that we can see. But I want to tell you something. Somebody somewhere has got to refuse and say, you do what you want to, Jack. But I know the scripture. And it said, don't have any other gods. It said, the Lord our God, Him only shalt thou serve, Him only shalt thou worship, Him only shalt thou love. Ladies and gentlemen, we need some men and women that no matter the circumstances in today's society, that they are unafraid to stand up with their hands lifted and say, my Lord, I don't care what the rest of the world does, I'm going to stand out in Babylon. I want to tell you today that in Corinth, Mississippi, I'm seeing a lot of the ways of Babylon. I'm seeing a lot of the sins of Babylon, those images, and that music has been played. When people come to church and they just do whatever they want to, and the preacher says, oh, it don't matter how you live. Just giving the offering on the way out, my God. We still need somebody to say, we got to stand strong. We got to build a defense. We got to stand against the lies of the devil. We got to stand for something overpowering. It don't matter what the world is doing. It matters what the church I know y'all hate when I get political, but I can't help it. I just got to get this little political this morning. Somebody asked me this week, said, do you see the videos of old Donald Trump? And I said, well, yes, it is. Shocking, isn't it? And I said, I'll be